Welcome back to Inside City Hall. There may be 63 seats in the state Senate up in Albany, but you could make the argument that my next guest is occupying the single most important seat. That's because he has found himself, or some would say positioned himself, right in the middle of the power struggle for control of the Senate. Simcha Felder is a Democrat who conferences with the Republican caucus, giving them a very narrow majority. And now that Albany Democrats have pledged to work together, where does that leave him? Senator Felder represents parts of Brooklyn, including Borough Park and Midwood. He joins us now in our studios. Welcome. Very good to see you.
Thank you for having me.
As the man in the middle, we were regaled in the final hours of the budget with Simcha Felder holding up a $168 billion budget until he got a provision that he wanted. I want to talk about the substance of the provision, but is that accurately reported? You were aware that you had that leverage, and is that what you were doing toward
the end? I'm supposed to say absolutely so, because that's what we do. But I think I was just the scapegoat, and that there were many other issues that were being discussed and had to be worked down and hammered out. And it was easy to say, Felder and his yeshiva thing are responsible for holding up, you know, everything, which is absolutely not so. Absolutely not so.
Was that a compromise offer to you on it? I mean, why?
We did work something out. Yeah. It was being worked out, and I'm very proud of the fact that I try to do the best I can for my constituents, as I would hope any elected official does in their district for the people they represent. And it's not on the backs of New Yorkers elsewhere. And this really was just the opening salvo in what I believe should be a much deeper discussion on how to educate our children, whether they're in public school, non-public school, vocational schools, homeschool. It seems we have thousands and thousands of children that we're trying to squeeze into a cookie cutter model of some sort of education.
And okay, well, but let's not talk about a cookie cutter. I mean, there are core standards, right? There's a floor beneath which there are basic standards at all schools, whatever kind they are, and there are a lot of kinds of schools, including homeschooling, but everybody's got to meet a basic standard. The argument's being made that of the 57,000-odd kids who are in yeshivas, that a significant proportion of them, I don't know, 5%, 10%, could be 2%, are not getting that basic standard, and that is a violation, in effect, of the state education law. Does that concern you?
Oh, it would concern me if it was accurate. But first of all, I'd say there's many more children in the yeshiva system throughout New York State, probably closer to 200,000. And the legislation that I proposed really creates a pathway so that every child must have minimum number of secular subjects, such as writing, reading, arithmetic, history, and science, which are, no matter what you're going to wind up doing in your life, whether you're going to be a professor or whether you're going to be a contractor or anything like that. So the goal is not to eliminate or avoid or sort of give somebody the easy way out. Just the opposite. This was never clear in the law as to what a substantially equivalent education. And I would say quality over quantity. Mm-hmm. It's not about having X number of hours in school. It's about making sure that the outcome, that children have the most basic necessities to be able to lead a normal life.
Well, but I mean, are you suggesting that they test out at the end of some period of time?
Yes, absolutely.
And what would that test be?
It could be Regents exam. Look, I went through the yeshiva system. I don't know whether that's a plus or minus to my cause or my argument, but we had the basics that I told you about, and then we had Regents on those subjects. It's not as though it was a free-for-all, do whatever you want.
I mean, but look, it's an open secret, or at least it's an allegation that there are some yeshivas, not all, not even a majority, but there are some yeshivas where secular education, reading anything other than Torah, stops at, say, eighth grade, and there's no science, and there's not enough English, and there's not enough reading, and they're not going to be able to pass whatever test you or anybody else wants to impose on them at the end of that process. If we know, or we believe, or we have strong reason to believe, and people are saying over and over and over again that this is going on, what steps should be taken to actually address it?
So I think that if you read through my legislation carefully, I think that's exactly the steps that should be taken. It's very clear in the legislation as to the requirements in these core courses to make sure that any child in the city or state is proficient in, and they should be tested on it, and there are no exceptions to that. Yeah. We're not giving anybody a pass.
Well, but somebody is giving them a pass, though. I mean, the city's chancellor, the school's chancellor, now departed, but she said it would take about 2 months to figure out what's going on with these allegations. That was over 2 years ago. clearly the de Blasio administration is not going to look into this. People are operating in bad faith. People are saying that they're concerned about whether these kids are getting an education. And the reality is they either don't care or they're more interested in keeping the guys who run the yeshivas happy. And as long as that's the case, it leaves potentially thousands, hundreds, or even thousands of kids in a really, really bad position. Somebody's got to stand up for them, and I think that person should be you.
And I believe that's so, and I am standing up for them. And I would just say, with regard to your question, of course there are some schools that are not doing what they're supposed to. That's unfortunately life. You have good people and not so, you know, good people. There are schools that are not fulfilling their responsibility, and they have to be compelled to do so by law. But for the almost 200,000 kids that are being educated and getting other skills through their religious studies as well, like critical thinking, analytical thinking, logic, as well as the core courses, I think the legislation draws a path, a clear one, that's not something to be interpreted, that mandates exactly what you're saying.
Well, I mean, can we put some kind of a time limit on this? By what time would you say, you know, as a leader on this issue and in this community, to say to people like, look, whatever you folks are doing, you folks who are being accused of neglecting the kids, you've got to get right by a certain date. Like, either get it together or there's going to be consequences.
I think that's a good point. And since the legislation that I proposed was just passed by law, I would say that it's fair to say that in the coming school year, everyone has to be in compliance without any exception.
Okay, very good. I'll hold you to that, and we'll talk about it in the future. There have been reports, Crane's reported this, that you've got an office, one of your district offices, I think you have two, right? One of your district offices is in a building, it's about 500 odd square feet. In the same building is another 500 square feet that are paid for by your campaign. The government office is paying $5,800 a month, the other one's paying $250 a month, which looks like a possibly unlawful campaign contribution. What's the story with that?
I don't like using the term fake news, but it's appropriate. I invite you and any of your listeners to come to my office and see the walk-in closet that I'm paying $250 for. The reporter on this story did not do his homework, emphasized. He never saw the other space. He took an assumption in his mind. He saw one door and decided it's equal space. Right now, I'm paying a higher price per square foot for my campaign office, that $250, it's a walk-in closet, than the Senate is paying for the other space. The Senate is paying less per square foot. So any of your listeners want to come see the beautiful closet office and see all our space, I challenge him. He never saw the space.
As you know, many of your colleagues avoid this question altogether by having it, even if it's just half a block away, put the campaign office somewhere else.
You know, you're right.
These questions don't come up.
I am guilty of the perception, and that I admit, that it should be somewhere else. But of an illegality? Absolutely not. Come see the space. Come see it.
Very good. The question of unification. Everyone keeps saying the Democrats are going to now unify, the IDC goes away, they're going to all be together. The question, what about Senator Felder? And what Andrew Stewart Cousins has said, she was sitting right in that chair, as a matter of fact, what she has said over and over again is she's talked with Senator Felder. Senator Felder's going to join all the other Democrats once the elections are over, the special elections on April 24th. Is that the case?
Well, I can't say that's the case exactly. Well, I have a great, great admiration and respect for Senator Stewart Cousins. What I think I said to her was that I am open to thinking about anything. I'm not a loyal Democrat. I'm not a loyal Republican. I try to serve my constituents. I don't think party affiliation is that important anymore. And we see more and more New Yorkers, as well as people throughout the country, saying, I don't care. Is this guy going to be able to do what we need to get done to improve quality of life, to make sure that we get the services that we need? And with that in mind, I am not determined to be number 32 in the Democratic Party or to be number 32 in the Republican Party. I'm trying to leverage, and I'm very proud of it. And again, I would hope anyone in my position would do the same, to get the most I can for my constituents without doing it on other New Yorkers' backs.
Well, inevitably there are consequences for others. Like, you voted against the DREAM Act, right? You were one of two votes against it that stopped the bill from passing.
Yes.
That has implications for a whole lot of New Yorkers, right?
I admit to you wholeheartedly that on some occasions that does work that way. Mm-hmm. But for example, my battle to get rid of the bag tax was something that was important to my constituents as well as all other New Yorkers. I don't believe that I did that on somebody else's back.
Well, of course you did. I mean, the whole thing is about pollution and solid waste, right? There's going to be a lot more solid waste than there would have been.
There is a debate, which we can have, as long as you want to keep me on for another 20 minutes, as to whether that's actually so.
Well, I mean, look, the point, though, is that this isn't just a guy taking care of a handful of people in your district. This has implications for 19 million, 20-odd million people here in the state.
Yeah, but no one would go ahead and criticize you if, let's say, you were the deciding vote, if there was a Senate race and you were the deciding vote, or 10 people were the deciding vote, and they said, we don't like that guy. You voted for that guy, but we don't like him. Forget your vote. Mm. I mean, it's on a different level, but it's real a microcosm of that.
No, but surely your sense of the public good that you are sworn to try and uphold includes the possibility that something that might be unpopular in your district is what is best for New York State, right?
That is true.
Yeah.
That is absolutely true. Mm-hmm. And then I would have a moral dilemma as to what I should do.
You're going to get those every day.
I hope not as many as you're predicting.
Okay, fair enough.